My guess is that almost everybody likes superhero movies, and the character named Thor makes no exception from that rule. So I think you should like Volvo, because the Swedish producer has hidden a little Thor inside those headlights. They have the shape of its hammer, and when describing this car in marketing terms, they really use that name when referring to the daytime running lights and the turn signal indicators. But apart from that, you should really like Volvo, because it is a strong branded premium car that has been around since 1927 or so. And starting with the 1980s especially, they built a lot of turbocharged engines that were called Volvo Red Block back then. They started developing more engines. They added the modular family with 5 or 6 cylinder engines placed inline transversely or longitudinally. So while initially they had a rear wheel drive, now they are all front wheel drive based, but they still employ an all wheel drive system, although not with Haldex company, but with GKN, the British manufacturer of axles and differentials. And they are really interesting cars, because they use only 4-cylinder engines starting with 2013. Whether if they are gasoline, diesel, mild hybrid or full plug-in hybrid like this one. This is a Volvo S90. This name has been used before, starting with the 1990s, with the largest sedan and the last Volvo rear-wheel drive sedan. And it had inline-6 engines up to 2.9-liter capacity and around 204 horsepower, rear-wheel drive with independent suspension all around. It was an interesting premium car. And this one, although it bears the same name, it does not have any similarity from a technical point of view. So this car uses an interesting engine, which we are going to talk about today, because Volvo engine architecture started in 2013 with 2-liter 4-cylinder engines, all diesel or gasoline, and they have had an interesting downsize to 1.5, 3 or 4 cylinder only for the petrol variants. And now they only employ this kind of system with interesting turbocharging, supercharging, but because they are 3 generations of these engines, you will see technical differences between them. Some of them have 1 turbocharger, some of them have 2, and they are all diesels. The gasolines always have at least 1 turbocharger, twin scroll for the 4-cylinder variants, a normal one for the 3-cylinder variants. And the most powerful versions of the 4-cylinder gasoline engines also employ a supercharger for the first and second generations of the engines, and now they have an electrical supercharger, but only for the mild hybrid B6 variant. This, because it's the strongest one, has 455 horsepower and 709 newton meters out of a petrol engine that develops 310 horsepower on its own and 400 newton meters. It has a crank-started generator that has 47 horsepower and 150 newton meters. And on the rear axle, you get the GKN's ERAD. Electric rear axle drive, which is actually built under contract by the company called Schaeffler in China, and it develops 145 horsepower and 309 newton meters. The former variants up until 2022 had 87 horsepower on the rear wheel and 240 newton meters, and the gasoline engine was about at the same power level, but it employed a mechanical supercharger for low revs and a twin scroll turbocharger for high revs with a bypassing system between them. Now this car only has a turbocharger, and the role of the supercharger is taken care of by that crank starter generator. And the B6 variant, which is not a plug-in hybrid, does not have that rear electric axle drive, and it instead uses a shaft, a propeller shaft, with a real differential made by GKN, not by Haldex, because they don't have a partnership anymore. And the engine employs an electrical 48-volt BorgWarner e-booster supercharger that is for low revs, and it is fed by the electrical 48-volt system from the mild hybrid belt starter generator. And for higher revs, we have a twin scroll turbo. So that's about it with the technical specifications in numbers. Let's see a bit around the car, inside of it and under the hood, because I think you'll find this technique very interesting. And I think you should try to test drive one, and you will convince yourself that even if it is a very downsized engine for its power, you don't feel that downsizing. The car is extremely fast, so it reaches its top speed in around 14 seconds, 100 kilometers per hour in maximum 4.6 seconds, and any kind of acceleration in rolling starts from 60, 40, 80, 120 kilometers per hour takes place in less than 4 seconds. So it's like fast as Thor's hammer, I don't know, like a lightning. And you shouldn't judge the size of the engine, you should judge the whole system capacity. And for sure, it pulls like a minimum 3-liter inline six engine or maybe a 4.4 liter V8 twin turbocharged engine. So please try one and tell me in the comment section what do you think about its acceleration. Stick around to find out more. Design-wise, it is a very interesting car because the proportions are very tamed, I think, and it has cues from the past. If you look at the rear window, you will see a thing that is similar with BMW's Hofmeister King. But actually, this kind of rear shape has been used in that P1800 model from the 1960s, and it's nice that you can see this legacy style of design. The Thor headlights are new, the Thor's hammer headlights and rear lights, which are full LED. By the way, these, I think, are one of the most interesting headlights I've ever tested because they truly make day from night. And you get a lot of luxury amenities like an electric opening and closing trunk. They say the boot has 415 liters capacity, but from my point of view, I think it's way larger, at least 100 liters more. And because it is a plug-in hybrid, it has storing capacity that is a bit less from a normal variant, but the battery is placed where the normal prop shaft would have been, because this car has an electrical all-wheel drive system. It does not have a prop shaft, a transfer case, and a differential. It has units in the front and in the back, so you get that space filled with batteries. I like that you can store the cable there, and you have storage space under this boot, and it is well finished except for the upper part of that lid there. And this is just a small inconvenience. The interior is absolutely lovely. You get to choose between a wool based upholstery, you get a textile one, and this one is a Napa leather. You get different types of leather in different colors. The rear seats have electrical heating, they don't have ventilation. You don't get to adjust them, but they have automatic lowering headrests. And you get an interesting cup holder here, which has like an old school mechanism, which I really love because it feels nice. You get ventilation on B pillars here, not on the center, and you get a two-zone climate control in the rear for the models that aren't plug-in hybrid, because you get a lot of batteries inside there, and you also lose the wireless charger in the central console in the front. Very well insulated, you get mechanical curtains here, and an electrical curtain in the back, which is controlled from the screen. Sadly, no buttons anymore. And all the mirrors are self-dimming when night outside. Very good materials. The system, audio system, is a Harman Kardon, and optional you can get a Bowers & Wilkins, which costs about 4,000 euros, but it's worth the money because the sound is very good. This is like a Sensatec material. It's a artificial leather, but it's all around the door, and it is very soft, including in the lower part. The seats are lovely. They have between 10 and 14 electrical adjustments, because you get the 8 standard adjustment here, and you have similar adjustments from this joystick. For example, you get the lumbar support, but if you press on this button with the same controls, you can extend or retract this section and inflate or deflate these upper bolsters. And also that central part, you get a massage seat, you have memories, and you can adjust this seat with the controls from the driver. And in this central part, you get a simple console. Sadly, not a lot of space here. And because the system is Google based, you don't have the permission to use a stick. If you insert a music stick here, you won't hear anything in the audio system, so you have to connect your smartphone. But a future update will appear. Cup holders here. This crystal shifter is illuminated. This is the starter of a car. You have electrical brakes, so this means that you don't have to use the auto hold because you have a one pedal mode, and a portrait screen, just like Tesla uses. Ventilated, heated seats, heated steering wheel, and from the driver's point of view, you get an interesting leather two-tone steering wheel, which feels very nice to the touch, very minimalistic controls. You get an optional head-up display. This central screen here has a simple view and one with a central map, which works lovely. And you also get the navigation on the central screen. So that's about it for the interior. Let's move on to the interesting part for our channel, which is the engine. Charging port, 3.6 kilowatt hour there, and the gasoline port in the back. It's interesting that if you follow this arrow here, you will find a switch that lets you open the hood. And when the hood is closed, this switch is pressed like this, so it pops up so you can reach it more easily. So here you have an interesting engine bay. It's soundproof insulated there. You also have a pillow cushion that stands upon the engine, but I removed it so I can film this with a lot of details here. And this is an engine that has a code B420456. The former T8 twin charged engine had an extension with 35, 26, 28 or 36. So this is a newer variant of the engine, and you can see the lack of the supercharger. No belt driven here supercharger, and the pulley from the crankshaft does not contain a belt over it, so it's just a damping system. All in all, the engine is built from aluminium. Every part of it is made of aluminium on the outside, with exception being the intake manifold and the piping for the turbo, and this canister that manages the gases inside the crankcase, the evap canister and the crankcase breather, as it is called. So you will find in this engine a timing system made of a belt, and this belt can be accessed very easily for inspection. You can see it there, and it runs over two pinions. These pinions contain the VVT system, which is controlled by the solenoids here, and the belt runs down from the crankshaft. You get a chain-driven variable displacement oil pump, which is in the sump, and the electrical components are placed around the engine. For example, you get an electrical air conditioning compressor and an electrical water pump. The diesel variants have a belt because they don't employ a plug-in hybrid system, and the water pump is mechanical, placed on the accessory belt. This is a direct injected engine, so one of the camshafts, the exhaust one, drives two elements. Drives the injection pump, which connects to a central fuel rail that has four injectors and near it the four connections with the spark plugs. And you get a normal direct injection system, no port injection here. And in the same housing with the injection pump, you get a vacuum pump, which is not necessarily for brakes, but it manages the active engine mounts and also the wastegated turbo. And I think it's very good that they use a pneumatical wastegate and not an electrical motor driven one, because the engine gets hot and electrical motors with plastic elements and heat, for sure they won't mix well. So you get a pneumatic solenoid here that is fed by the vacuum from the pump, but you also get a vacuum canister, so the wastegate can adjust even when the engine is at low revs and the vacuum pump does not create a full depression. So this connection leads to the vacuum actuator for the turbo. And in the past, you had a supercharger with a belt placed here on the intake and with another solenoid that controlled the bypass valve. Now you get an electrical compressor made by BorgWarner, which is fed by that 48 volt system, but only on the B6 variant, the gasoline 300 horsepower. And all engines, diesel or gasoline, have the same kind of pistons, but with different shape. And between the gasoline engines, you get also differences, because you have engines that have a 12.0 compression ratio. Others have 10.5, this one has 10.3, and the super and turbocharged one, the twin-charged engine, has 9.0:1 compression ratio. So, you have different piston shapes because of different boost levels. And the intake manifold is made of plastic. You have the electrical accelerator pedal. And you have all sorts of pipes here that manage the purging of the fuel tank and the crankcase gases. So, for example, you get a double path here, which employs the use of vacuum. When the engine is under light load, you get vacuum in the intake manifold. And the turbo has positive pressure. So this means you can ventilate the crankshaft, crankcase gases through this hose. So the turbo feeds clean air inside the engine. And that air replaces dirty crankcase gases that are sucked with this unit through this valve and inserted into intake manifold where you have vacuum. And in a similar manner, the purging of the canister, evap canister from the fuel tank, those unburned fuel vapors, are vented through the intake manifold through this hose. You have a purging solenoid that acts here and it gets vacuum. From the vacuum sucks those gases inside the intake manifold. When the engine is during boost, you have positive pressure in the intake and negative pressure at the intake side of the turbocharger, at the compressor side of the wheel. So the roles switch. So this piping has a lot of one-way valves like this one, and the function reverts. So because the vacuum is there, you get those gases through this connection before the entrance of the turbocharger, and this unit switches through this valve, blocks the intake path so that positive pressure won't enter the crankcase. And because you have positive pressure with gases inside the crankcase, because they seep around the between the piston and the piston wall, and those gases are inserted through the vacuum hose inside the intake part of the turbocharger. The exhaust gallery is placed, the manifold has individual tubes and it is a twin scroll design, so you have a pair of the cylinder 1 and 4 on a separate path from the cylinders 2 and 3, and they mix in front of the turbocharger with a double path in the housing. And this means that this turbo behaves well even under low load or high load, and this is a system that has been used for decades now, and I think is the best one regarding an even number of cylinders in a turbocharged engine. Another timing related interesting stuff is that the gasoline variant has mechanical solid lifters, so the camshafts that are made of iron press directly on those lifters that lift the cams, the valves, sorry. The diesel variant has steel camshafts that have roller finger followers that are hydraulically compensated. So you have a different manner of actuating the valves. And when you look at the lateral side of the engine, you'll see the thermostat and all the hoses that actually come from the central part here and split around here. You have a metal pipe that cools the engine, and you have three cooling circuits. You will have circuits, is the correct pronunciation. You have a normal expansion tank here for the cooling of the engine, and of course you have a split cooling for the block and the head, which are kept at different temperatures. You have that electrical pump that manages flow through a normal high temperature radiator, and you have an additional two cooling circuits that have an expansion tank that is placed here in front of the wiper, so it's accessible only by the dealer through that gap. And you have a cooling circuit that manages the crank motor and the rear axle motor. And the other cooling circuit manages the inverter converter assembly and the rear battery, which can be cooled through the antifreeze through another radiator in the front, or can be actively cooled using the air conditioning system that has a heat exchanger. And this pipe leads to the back of the car where it cools the battery. So it's an interesting thermal management which uses electrical pumps and different radiators, but let's pray that it won't fail, because it will be expensive to repair if the car will not be under warranty. So basically you get this big lump of aluminium, the engine, that produces 310 horsepower and 400 newton meters. On its flywheel you have that secondary motor generator that also can start the engine. You don't have a normal crankshaft starter. you don't have a belt starter, generator or alternator, so that motor can start the engine, can be driven by the engine so it produces electricity, can recover electricity when it's spun by the wheels and gearbox, and can also act as an alternator for the large system battery. And the 12-volt battery is charged to a stepped low-voltage DC-DC converter. So this unit here is the inverter for the crank generator, so you can see three sets of alternate current cables that go inside that motor, and two sets of cables direct current that comes from the battery, and this direct current line goes directly to this air conditioning electric compressor. You get a second unit like this that is stuck to the battery, and it feeds the rear motor, so you get an interesting electrical system. The gearbox is an Aisin AWF8F55, so it's that normal 8-speed Aisin that is built by Toyota, and on this car it has a normal torque converter and 8 forward speeds and 1 backward speed, so it's a planetary style torque converter gearbox. In comparison, Stellantis, which owns Peugeot, Citroën brands and Opels that have a plug-in hybrid system that employs a different a similar kind actually of Aisin gearbox, uses another system because it replaces the torque converter with a 110 horsepower and 325 newton meters electric motor, and it still has the 8 gears, but it does not employ a torque converter. So here, although it is an Aisin gearbox, it's totally different from that one. So this car, mainly when it runs electric, it's rear wheel drive, and rest of the time will be front or all-wheel drive, and you have different power modes for selecting that. The suspension is a double wishbone type, so you get an upper arm that is shorter than the lower one, so it's actually an SLA suspension, short long arm, and under the wheel you have a lower wishbone that is way larger than the upper one. So this means that you have a perfect contact patch for it. And on the rear you have a system with three big arms. You have a big arm that contains the spring and the shock absorber, whether they are electronically controlled or not, or they have pneumatic suspension or not. Another lower arm for guiding, for tow in and tow out, and an upper arm for stability. So you have three arms that have the shape of forearms. It's a multi-link suspension with an anti-roll bar, and you get an interesting plastic spring that is very similar to what Corvette uses. So if you look at the suspension under the car, you will see the suspension arms, and instead of those spiraled springs on top, the helicoidal springs, you will get a single plastic polymer spring that runs like a crossbow from one side to the other. The first S90 also used this system. Corvette uses it since, I don't know, 1980s, and it's very interesting because the system is very light. It is rust proof because basically it's a polymer, so it's plastic, and it cannot break. So it uses a lot less room than a normal one, and this car has a lot lower unsprung mass suspension. My dear followers, this has been the review. I felt very confident while presenting this car without having a script. I know all these details because I'm passionate about the car, and I really loved my English during this video. I think I made a lot less mistakes than the other videos where I was I had the stage fright, as it is called. So thank you for watching this video. Please comment in the lower comment section, because I really want to find your opinion. Do you think Volvos are slow? Do you think that these models are underpowered because they use a 2-liter engine? Remember, it is a 2-liter engine, but it has another two electrical motors, it's all-wheel drive, and it develops close to 500 horsepower. If you add all those numbers, you most certainly reach a value of about 500 horsepower at the wheels, because the car is really, really fast in comparison with former models that were only turbocharged and had around 250, 260 horsepower. But as a fan of this brand, I will always miss and prefer the inline 6 and inline 5 turbo engines that had a distinct sound and a distinct shape, and they drove very, very good, but with a lot higher fuel consumption than this one. For example, this car, when driven at its maximum speed, consumes about 13 liters per 100 kilometers. If you drive it at 140 kilometers per hour, it consumes around 9.7. If you drive slow on national roads with an average speed of around 70 kilometers per hour, the fuel consumption will be about 4.6 liters. And during town, you will see between 6 and 11, depends on the driving style. So this car, I think, is very, very closely related as a power level and the driving feel with BMW's 545e. But that BMW has an interesting choice. It is an interesting choice because it has an inline 6 3-liter engine coupled to electrical motor that is in the gearbox, and it's a four-wheel drive car with actual drive shaft. So please comment and let me know what you think about all these technical details. Bye-bye!